Thomas. I'm going to be giving out a RISC-V intro update. So I have some. You guys want to learn more about the ISA? Kurt's trying to get rid of these. He's got how many do you have of these?
A couple thousand.
He's got a couple thousand. So you guys should definitely grab some.
I'm sure we have an IBM one.
Give me your kids. I do. So Dave Patterson actually told us which that it had to be on this specific.
Oh, it's kind of paper. I went to university stationery just to get that stuff. We didn't have it on.
But Kurt, he made it happen. He got the right color, and so you guys should pick some up. So yeah, this should be interactive. If you guys have questions, just shout. I have some slides, but yeah, just if you have any questions, commentary, whatever, just shout. So RISC-V, how many of you have heard of it? Okay, so I gave a talk last year or something about it's kind of a basic intro. So I'll kind of redo the intro and then talk a little bit about some of the new things that have happened in the last year. So it's interesting. I'll start off with some of my biases. So this is sort of where I'm coming from. So I'm kind of an unabashed open hardware enthusiast. So I cut my teeth on, when I was in school, on open cores, open RISC, open Spark. So it's differing a little bit. And then I designed an ISA that fourth year computer engineering students were forced to implement. And I feel really bad for those students. I mean, it was not a particularly nice ISA, but they were forced to implement it because they needed to graduate. So if RISC-V existed at that time, I would use it. It's a much cleaner ISA. But yeah, so I've been a kind of armchair ISA designer. I worked on the DARPA Crash Safe project. So this was it's like one of these, you know, DARPA does these kind of moonshot kind of projects, so they tend to be really ambitious. So the Crash Safe project was basically, we're going to throw away all of computing and start over. So we're going to build a completely secure hardware software stack, so we're building new processors, new languages, new operating systems, that sort of thing. And so recently what I've been working on is bringing some of the hardware features from the Crash Safe project to our RISC-V. Mostly because RISC-V is becoming sort of the kind of nexus for open hardware, and a lot of researchers and academics are starting to use it. So that's kind of like where I've been on the hardware side. I'm a big fan of open hardware. And on the software side, I was a Gentoo Linux developer. I worked on the Minix 3 operating system, which is kind of a secure microkernel designed for kind of high reliability. So I'm a low-level kernel firmware hacker. Most of the work I do has been sort of the hardware software interface, so operating systems, compilers, dynamic instrumentation, virtual machines, that kind of thing. And also I do a fair amount of security research. And recently I've been helping out with, you know, the FreeBSD RISC-V port and sort of building out some of the software on the RISC-V platform, so simulators, trying to get Linux kernel and things like that up as well, firmware, etc. So these are sort of my biases. And so I've also been sort of kind of an unofficial like RISC-V ambassador. So this is the fifth RISC-V talk I've given in the last year. I'm giving another one at the Embedded Systems Conference, and I think I have another one after that. So for some reason, I've been talking about RISC-V a lot. So RISC-V, what is it? So it's an open instruction set specification. So it's not actually, it's an ISA spec, so you can actually have open source implementations of the processor or even proprietary implementations. As long as you meet the spec, you can do whatever you want with it. So the nice thing about this is if you're a researcher or if you're a company, you don't have to license the ISA. So for instance, if you want to build your own ARM processor, you have to pay royalties to ARM. And that can be fairly expensive, and actually you have to get lawyers involved, and that's always a pain. So actually getting the IP agreements done is fairly painful. Alright, so RISC-V. You can blame these guys, Dave Patterson and Chris Lasage. So, does anybody know what Dave Patterson is kind of known for? So, yeah. So, interesting thing about Dave Patterson is that he holds the California state record for the deadlift in his age range. So that's not actually what he's known for. If you guys have heard of RAID, redundant array of inexpensive disks, he came up with that idea. He also came up with RISC, reduced instruction set computer, which if you're an architect, He and Hennessy kind of did it about the same time. So he's pretty well known in the architecture community, and he recently retired. And he was here fairly recently. He gave a talk at Harvard, right? So talking about RISC-V. Chris Sosnovich is also pretty well known in the architecture community. He's done a lot of pretty interesting research as well. He gave a talk recently at MIT Data Center, also about RISC-V. And so basically what they were doing, so they've done a lot of different architecture, new processors, vector processors, different things. And so they, at the beginning, they basically create a new lab every 5 years. And so they're starting up the Aspire lab at Berkeley. They were looking for a new, they knew they were gonna build new processors, and they were trying to decide which ISA they should use. And so they kind of looked at the usual suspects, x86, ARM, Spark, MIPS. They kind of used all of these over many years, but they realized that none of them really fit their needs.
Which firmware did they decide to use? Did they decide to use open firmware as opposed to that insanely called UEFI?
So they don't have they don't have a standard yet. There is a UEFI implementation that the HP Enterprise folks are building. So it'll be interesting to see. So UEFI is becoming kind of the standard for server platforms and desktop platforms. So it's possible that UEFI will be maybe a standard, will be kind of like a standard firmware for a certain class of machines. But for microcontrollers and things like that, it'll make sense. But I'll talk about this a little bit later. There's a lot of these things that haven't really been defined. So RISC-V is relatively new, so a lot of the software stack. And so I gave a talk at the RISC-V workshop sort of about this. There's a lot of these issues that Berkeley and the community and everyone are gonna have to sort of work through. So x86, too complicated, you can't license it. I mean, there are IP issues. ARM is also really complicated. So they thought, what the hell, we're architects, let's design our own ISA. So that's where we ended up with RISC-V. So RISC-V has a very modest goal. And so the modest goal is to become the standard ISA for all computing devices. So everything in your computer, your video card, every single block in your SoC, their goal is to have that running RISC-V. It's a modest goal. And they're targeting microcontrollers all the way to supercomputers. And there's a number of people who are creating different chips and different classes. And I'll talk a little bit about who's doing what. And so it's designed for research. There's a lot of fairly interesting research that people are doing. At MIT, Arvin's group's doing some pretty cool stuff with the memory models and things like that. Andy Wright gave a talk at the RISC-V workshop. For education, MIT's also teaching a course on using RISC-V, so is Berkeley, obviously. University of Cambridge is also teaching RISC-V courses for their architecture courses. And for commercial use, it's starting to get adoption. There's been a few companies that have released products using RISC-V. For commercial use, if you're a startup, I would consider using RISC-V, just because you don't have to deal with the licensing, and you don't have to deal with lawyers, which is always good. It's not as mature as ARM. So, I mean, the nice thing about ARM is that you can kind of grab all these SoC blocks and kind of just do that. So, if your time horizons, you have to release a product like in the next year, then maybe you want to get your lawyers on the phone and build something around ARM. But I'd see in the next, maybe the next 3 year time frame, I can see RISC-V being fairly useful. People are actually releasing products using RISC-V, so that's pretty cool. So why is it called RISC-V? So it's the fifth RISC ISA from Berkeley, so RISC-V or RISC-V, so Roman numeral 5. And the cool thing about RISC-V is it's a modular ISA. So there's a simple base instruction set, and you can find it on here. And there's only, it's a standard RISC instruction set. So you get load, stores, various arithmetic operations. And so the base ISA has fewer than 50 hardware instructions. So it's pretty small. You can implement it, you can use it for a microcontroller, and you can sort of layer extensions on top of that.
PPA only had 15.
What's that?
PPA had 15.
15, okay. Well, that's pretty small.
Is that four?
That's pretty small. So, yeah.
And you only have to have one. Flip bit and branch conditionally. Anything else is purely optional.
Yes, yes, we should get rid of all of those. So yeah, you guys can create your own ISAs. So yeah, basically this will have your standard RISC subset. So load stores, load intake, etc. Branching. They have 32 bit, 64 bit, and they've been spec'd with how 128 bit ISA. Apparently, there's some data center folks that are interested in that. So they have this base ISA with 50 instructions, and you can layer extensions on top of that. So you can add a multiply, divide instruction, single, double, quad, floating point, and there'll be more extensions over time. So there's people who are looking at security extensions, like me, people looking at vector extensions. So over time, there'll be more and more extensions, some non-standard, some standard. So recently announced, this is new since the last time I talked about RISC-V, so there's a RISC-V Foundation, so people are actually putting up money to support RISC-V. And so some of the companies, so I don't know if any of you saw the E Times article, but the E Times article basically just mentioned Google, I think HP and Oracle, and maybe Microsoft. So these guys have put some money behind RISC-V. Locally, BlueSpec is doing a lot of stuff with RISC-V, Draper is also doing RISC-V stuff. Sci-5 is, Chris Asanovich and his students have started a new company around RISC-V, and so Chris is on leave for a year, so they're basically going to be doing building RISC-V course, and it's actually a good thing. So one of the concerns with these sorts of projects is that you have these grad students, and they once they graduate, they're like done, and the project goes away. But because they've actually started, they have a foundation, they have this company, there's actually, and this been a fair amount of adoption from various research groups and industry. I see RISC-V sort of as here to stay. And then, so you have a number of other companies that are sort of smaller. So Rumble Development is a company that they built the security camera using RISC-V, and they've actually shipped a product doing that. Ant Micro is building an open source 4K camera using RISC-V. Lattice is an FPGA company. Low Risk is pretty interesting. I'll talk a little bit more about them. They're building a completely open SoC and hobbyist board there. It's the same people that brought you the Raspberry Pi, so that's pretty interesting. And Gray Research is doing fairly interesting things with FPGA accelerators using RISC-V. So some of the open source RISC-V cores that are out there that you can actually grab on GitHub, which is actually pretty cool. From Berkeley, there's a number of them. So Berkeley has this thing where they really like trains, so everything's kind of got a train theme. So there's the rocket ship generator, which is kind of like their main implementation. So it's like a five-stage core. Then recently, they released Boom, which is the Berkeley out-of-order machine. So that's an out-of-order super-scaling machine. All right, it's coming back. Zscale is their microcontroller. So they actually have an open source microcontroller class. RISC-V machine. Yeah, right. And SOTR is their set of educational cores. They have one stage all the way to five stage, so that's what they use in, when they teach their courses. And you can grab all these from GitHub, from them, and basically if you have any fixes or features you want to add, you can make pull requests. And the Berkeley people are generally fairly responsive to contributors.
Excuse me. Sure. Are you talking about like actual CPU hardware?
Yeah.
So does GitHub just have the plans for the hardware?
So they have the hard, so if they have, these cores are written in VHDL, Verilog, BlueSpec, Chisel, whatever. So you basically just grab the VHDL. And so what you can do is you grab the VHDL, and you, if you have access to EDA tools, you can fabricate the chip. If you don't, you can target an FPGA. So the Berkeley cores, this is, so typically people write these things in like VHDL or Verilog. In industry, Verilog is typically used more. VHDL is used in academia and I think Europe as well.
IBM.
What's that?
IBM is the only place.
IBM, yeah.
That
yeah. So there's a couple other higher level hardware description languages. So Berkeley uses this thing called Chisel, which is sort of, it's a nicer hardware description language, I would say. It's sort of built off, it's based on the Scala. So it uses some functional programming paradigms that makes it a little bit more expressive. BlueSpec's another higher, like locally, is another higher, they have a nicer HDL. It's kind of based on Haskell and term rewriting systems. And so. But you can find implementations in VHDL, Verilog, BlueSpec, Chisel, MyHDL. So pretty much any hardware description language you can find a core. So yeah, the low risk project from the University of Cambridge is also pretty interesting. So they're doing, so they want to build a completely open SoC, an open board. And so they call it, so it's from the Raspberry Pi folks, and so they're calling it Raspberry Pi for grown-ups. So they're not targeting kids, they're targeting people who are actually, I don't know, one, maybe, I don't know. So they have a couple interesting features they have is they're actually adding tagging extensions for security. So by adding sort of like basic metadata tagging, they can get rid of simple buffer overflows and things like that. They also have some interesting ideas around I/O. They have this idea about minion cores where you can sort of offload I/O. So that's, some of their concepts are kind of in the early stages, but it's definitely worth watching. And so they should be coming out with a test chip. They said sometime this year or next year. So they're really, I think they're trying to get a test chip this year. So. But eventually they'll have hobbyist boards that people can get, so that should be pretty interesting. And you can actually watch their development on GitHub, so they've been doing all of their development specifications and everything on GitHub, so that's been pretty cool. So IIT Madras, or IIT Chennai, they're also building a bunch of, their cores are in BlueSpec. They're building six different cores from microcontrollers all the way to like supercomputer class machines. And so you can find their stuff on Bitbucket. So. There was another E Times article recently about the government of India, and they're also building cores. So there's a lot of new CPUs coming out of India that are RISC-V based. I think, so Dave Patterson told me that, or in one of his talks he mentioned that RISC-V is going to be the standard ISA for India, so that's kind of interesting. Another interesting RISC-V core is this YARBI thing, so it stands for yet another RISC-V implementation. And so this is a really simple core. I think it's written in BHDL. This is what they use in the University of Cambridge course. It's really very simple. So there's a whole bunch of these. So this is sort of a small sampling of the RISC-V cores that are out there. There are a lot more if you just go on GitHub. And obviously you can create your own if you're so inclined. So I'll talk a little bit about the current software landscape. This will be fairly quick. If you want to learn more about the software landscape, my RISC-V workshop talk is online. Although Kurt told me the audio is messed up, I guess.
Yeah, so this may take its place after we're done recording.
Yeah, so there are slides. The slides are up. So there are a number of OS ports in progress. So there's Linux. Are you guys familiar with Yocto Open Embedded? So it's designed for basically embedded systems. It's fairly light. So there's a basic port there. There's also a Gen 2 port. So RISC-V actually, compared to a lot of other open hardware projects, has come far, because in a very short period of time, it's come a long way in terms of their software support. But there's still a fair bit of software that needs to get ported, and there's a fair amount of work to do still. So although they have initial ports, the changes haven't been upstreamed. That takes a while. You have to get through the review process. You have to kind of do, for instance, for the tool chain patches, you have to do copyright assignment paperwork for the Free Software Foundation. So that stuff will take a little while, but it's in progress. So once that's done, then eventually we can get to the point where you can just grab Debian RISC-V port and just run that. So that's kind of what we're working towards. So, but there are basic ports of Yocto Open Embedded and Gentoo. There's a FreeBSD port. So FreeBSD is actually kind of interesting. So FreeBSD is going to be it's currently the best supported platform for RISC-V, just because you can just grab, if you go to SVN, FreeBSD's SVN, you can grab the FreeBSD distribution and build it for RISC-V. All the toolchain support, it's already been upstreamed. Whereas for Linux, it hasn't been upstreamed yet. You can do it, but it hasn't been integrated into the upstream distribution. There's a NetBSD port in progress, and then there's also a port of SEL4, which is, so I'm a former microkernel person, so this is actually pretty exciting for me. So L4 is a formally verified microkernel, and sort of an interesting platform. And there's actually been some work on formalizing the RISC-V ISA, so I think there'll be some pretty cool research kind of tying the formal model of the RISC-V ISA with SEL4. So there's also support for the primary open source toolchains, binutils, GCC. Clang LVM is a port in progress, but it needs some more work. And then there's a number of software simulators and emulators. Spike is it's kind of the canonical simulator that everyone uses, but there's also QMU Angel, which is a JavaScript simulator, and Gem5, which is an architectural simulator that is in progress. So this is what a lot of architects use when they're doing sort of exploration.
So after you've got your tool chains, isn't porting your distro of choice just an automated process?
It's not automated. You basically have to add support for different things. So having glibc, your tool chain, all that in Linux kernel is a lot of it, but then you need to add things to like depackage and things like that. So some of the Gen2 bits have been starting to get upstream. So Gen2 may happen sooner. So there is a Debian developer who's interested in bringing the RISC-V port online, but basically he was saying that to make it happen, it'd be a lot easier just to have the tool chain stuff upstream. So he's kind of waiting for the tool chain to get upstream. I think once that happens, it'll come together. So low risk is applying to be a Google Summer of Code project. So I'm hoping that one of the things that maybe we can add to the project is something like maybe start on the Debian port. Maybe it won't be like an official port. Maybe it'll be something like Raspbian or something like that. But just kind of start the process. But it's hard to do when like your tool chain stuff isn't upstream though. So that's the thing that we've been kind of pushing to get that stuff upstream. So the Berkeley guys have been working through the FSF paperwork process. They're gonna start setting that stuff out for people. It will take a little while to get upstream. So there are a number of people who are contributing. So this only counts the software people, since I took this slide directly from my RISC-V software talk, but it's kind of interesting. You have, and this is also an underestimate. So basically, I only looked at the RISC-V GitHub organization, but there are already 48 contributors from a bunch of different places, universities, companies, open source projects. So you've got Berkeley, of course. They've contributed to it. University of Cambridge, Texas Tech, ETH Zurich, Cornell, NC State, University of Erlangen. MIT actually has also contributed. For companies, you've got BlueSpec, Google, LG, EA, MindFlare, SRI, VectorBlocks, all contributing. And then you've got people from Gen2, Debian, FreeBSD, and FBC also contributing to the RISC-V software stack. And there are a number of individual contributors that are either unaffiliated or I was able to figure out their affiliation. So the number of contributors has been sort of going up over time, and it's been pretty easy to get things upstream. But I've been really impressed at how quickly RISC-V folks have been responding to external contributions. So if you actually want to play around with RISC-V, you can grab a software emulator. So Spike is the kind of canonical emulator, but they have QMU support now, which is a little bit more convenient if you're a software person. They have this JavaScript emulator that I mentioned earlier, so you can actually boot RISC-V. You can boot Linux RISC-V in your browser, which is kind of cool.
There was a demonstration of booting Windows 95 in JavaScript.
Yeah, that's pretty interesting. Kind of painful, but interesting.
Someone actually did that.
And then if you have one of these FPGA platforms, you can also get RISC-V on there. So Zydo, Zboard, Kurt has all of them, I guess.
Yeah, everything that will fit. So not much can fit into the Zydo, which is too bad, because
yeah,
it's like 100 bucks or something.
Yeah. And it's also kind of hard to get now. I think someone said like the Zydo is maybe discontinued or something. All right, shut down. And then hopefully sometime, Low Risk is creating some test chips. Maybe next year they'll probably have some hobbyist boards for kind of like early adopters. So if you actually want to get into RISC-V, you should check out the green card, take some home. But there's also a number of specifications you can read. So the user-level ISA specification has been frozen. You can grab that. The privileged ISA specification, which you need if you want to write kernel code, is sort of, there's a draft version of it. It hasn't been frozen yet, but you can grab that online. They also have a compressed ISA specification. And then there have been three RISC-V workshops. And so the various slides and videos for the workshops are pretty interesting. There's tutorials that will help you get up and running on RISC-V for the software stack and for the hardware. If you actually want to sort of implement, add extensions to your RISC-V CPU, there are tutorials that tell you how to do that. So other useful supplemental reading, the Hennessy and Patterson books are good, and the CNIPS run book is good if you're doing any sort of like software hacking. RISC-V has sort of a MIPS lineage, which is based on who's been working on it. And so a lot of the, if you've used MIPS assembly, a lot of the RISC-V assembly will look pretty similar. A lot of the mnemonics and things are the same. Quick note about QE versus Spike. If you're doing hardware development, if you're basically modeling things, Spike is great. It's very simple. So I've been adding security extensions for RISC-V, so Spike's been pretty nice for that. But if you're actually trying to do software bring up, QE is much nicer. There's better device support, better debugging features. It's also more familiar to software people, and it's a bit faster. And it also does things like snapshots and things like that. So I would recommend, if you're, depending on what you're using it for, if you're just using it for doing software bring up, then QE is the way to go. So RISC-V is a fairly new project, so there's still a fair amount of work that needs to be done. And so if you're interested in open hardware, or if you're interested in computer architecture, you might consider contributing. So there's a lot of work to build out the software stack, although there's Linux and tool chains and things like that. It would be good to get the tool chain and QEMU upstreamed to kind of enable porting of Debian and other Linux distros and BSDs. More mature playing and LVM support would be pretty nice, especially for the previous D folks. And then upstreaming all the various OS ports, Yocto, Gentoo would be useful. A Debian RISC-V port would be useful as well. And eventually it would be interesting to start thinking about Android and perhaps a real-time OS like RTEMS or free RTOS or something like that. And then, so this is from my RISC-V talk about sort of improving RISC-V for sort of software developers. If there are Debian tool packages for the cross tool chain, QEMU would make things easier. And basically upstreaming everything would make things a lot easier. People could just go to kernel.org, grab a kernel, and build things, that would make things easier. And then just, if they can also build regular snapshots of OS images, that would be helpful. And so these are things that community members could help with. And so I've been helping with some of these things as well. There is a specification for the RISC-V CPU, but the platform itself needs more definition. So there's been some work on sort of defining the platform. So various devices, there's no standard interrupt controller, DMA, IOMMU, performance counters. The debug, they're starting to spec some of the debug features out. There's no specification for power management. So there's a fair amount of work that still needs to happen to define the platform. There's a lot more specifications for the platform. And ARM has actually done a good job here for ARM's game, so drawing some ideas from there would be useful in terms of the server architecture and the requirements and things like that. There is a UEFI version for RISC-V now. The HP Enterprise people did it. There's also Core Boot, and so that's kind of cool. There's also more work needed. Specifying RISC-V APIs. There's no hypervisor specification yet, and there's also more work that people are doing on security extensions. If you're a new developer, there's no RISC-V assembly guide, so these exist for MIPS, so if you're kind of coming up with RISC, if you're trying to get up to speed with RISC-V, you basically just kind of have to compile some code and look at the assembly dumps, so there's no kind of quick start guide, so there's some work that needs to be done there. ARM has this really good guide for the ARM Cortex-A. It basically tells you everything you might want to know about the ARM from the software perspective. So something like that for RISC-V would be useful, and new contributors guide would also be useful. So these things will get written over time. RISC-V is fairly new, so eventually it'll get there. So this is probably the most important slide, I guess. If you guys are free July 12th and 13th, the 4th RISC-V workshop will be in the Status Center. So whether you're interested in computer architecture or like building architecture, we've got you covered. So yeah, it's an interesting one.
I was looking through your instruction set here on this reference sheet. I do not see any logical /negation instruction anywhere on here.
Yeah, so you can implement that with, there is a mnemonic for that. So there's no actual instruction, but it uses one of the other instructions. So if you read the commentary, I don't know exactly which instructions it is, but you can do it. So in conclusion, RISC-V is an open instruction set specification. It's an excellent platform for computer architecture research and education. A lot of people are doing pretty interesting research. So Kurt and I were at the Boston Architecture Conference recently, and there were a number of kind of interesting RISC-V projects. So there was the BU guys were doing basically neural net accelerators, and Harvard was too, right? David Gross's group. And then Berkeley's doing some interesting stuff with silicon photonics. MIT, Arun's group's doing interesting things with verification and memory models and things like that. So there's a lot of interesting research going on. And it's a solid platform for various open hardware efforts. So Bunny Huang, who some of you are probably familiar with, he's been trying to create this open laptop, the Novena laptop. And so the problem, you can't actually, because Novena is using ARM chip, it's not completely open. So if you had a RISC-V chip in there, you could have a completely open laptop, which would be kind of interesting. And he's actually been involved, he's on the board for the low risk project, so maybe in the future there will be sort of an open laptop as well. So where you can help, if you're interested in this stuff, you can recruit developers, foundation members, you can help port new software, help with upstreaming, communities mode, various things like that. Questions?
So I may already know the answer to this, but in the old days when everything was a discrete chip, you know, memory controller, graphics, x87, you know, everything was discrete. Was there standards so that we could talk to some guy walks in with the new graphics processor, it's a discrete chip. Is there some standard that we can all subscribe to so that if you're the new graphics guy in town and you've got, and I'm kind of begging the question here, there is a GPL chip in New Hampshire, and it's called GPL GPU, and he'd love to participate in this, but it's beginning to look like he's going to have to be on die just to be able to work with an architecture that he is not familiar with. It sounds like more of a RISC-V problem than a his problem.
So currently, the buses that are, so I don't know enough about GPUs, I'm sure I can't really answer, but they have AXE interconnects that you can use, so Berkeley has different implementations of AXE4. So basically that's what they're using to kind of wire up the SoC. But in terms of GPUs, maybe, sure.
It depends, like, GPUs are typically massively high bandwidth. So you could go with AXE, but like really wide or have like several instantiations of AXE to cover your bandwidth. I don't know, I mean like a lot of the stuff on open source, for example, uses like Wishbone and two other types of buses.
Yeah.
They all have, you know, kind of different use cases. But if you want to lift other IP blocks from, you know, elsewhere, then being AXE compliant is easiest. So many like MediaTek and all these other types of companies that like license different, you know, IP blocks and slap it together and make an SoC, they won't talk to you unless you're AXE compliant. So AMBA protocols in general, that's what most of these kinds of open SoCs, that's what they use. But there's nothing stopping you from defining your own, like, you know, if somebody can define a new ISA, somebody can define a new bus and say, this is what we are recommending, and then everybody can get behind that.
Yeah, so the Berkeley guys are kind of, they're trying to use AXE, so they have implementations of the AXE buses.
So as long as those buses that the spec is open, so as long as you can go implement it, there's no reason to really invent your own, but unless, if there's legal, if, I haven't looked at it, but I don't know if there's any legal restrictions on
So I think at the RISC-V workshop, I think they said AXE 4 is open, but maybe like, was it get to version 5?
So the newer ones, I'm pretty sure they're not open.
Okay. So
particularly like the, like when you use ARM's own like cache coherent fabric, they use it some new protocol, and those are all, I don't think they're open.
Okay.
You need to pay for that. So that's where it gets tricky. But as long as you have royalty free, you know, access, and the ARM is not going to sue you, then it's okay.
don't need to see it. But in this case, yeah.
So that's how Rapid IO is going to get on it. Is there going to be ACSI compliant?
So Rapid IO is a different fabric, right?
Yeah.
So they have controllers, and I think the IT folks have their own Rapid IO controllers.
Oh, okay. Yeah, okay.
So they have their own blue spec implementations that are open source. As far as I know. I haven't looked at them.
What is LORIS using for our external IO, like PCIe, or like what kind of?
I don't know. I think they're basically, I think they were probably going to use ACSI. I don't actually know. They gave a talk on...
Off-chip?
I'm not sure, actually. Yeah. PCIe would make sense, but I don't actually know. They're currently just mostly focused on, I think, just having... Yeah, they're mostly just... Currently, they're just using, they're focused on on-chip and ACSI, I think, so... They don't really have a lot of peripherals at this point, so I think basically they just have serial. And I don't even know if they have a network yet, but they will soon, I'm sure.
It's been a while since I've looked at it.
So they gave a talk, and I can't remember the details. So they did a fair amount of work on sort of untethering the chip. So previously, what they've been using is they targeted the Zynq platform, so they could use the Linux, the Cortex-A9 to do a lot of the devices. And they actually untethered it, so you can actually run it on like a Vertex 7 chip. So they actually have some devices, but I don't remember which devices they have. So serial, and maybe they have disk, but I don't know if they have network control yet. So, but the talk's online, so you can see. And they also had a blog post and a tech report about it. So. But yeah, they've been making some pretty good progress. So I'm hoping it'll get to their test chip sometime this year. And hopefully have some early adopter boards in the next 2017 sometime. But yeah, it's a cool project.
All right, what's the status of the UEFI and the core boot?
So the UEFI, the HP Enterprise folks, one of the guys is actually on the UEFI, standards committee, or he's fairly high up, so they gave a talk at the RISC-V workshop. I think they have a basic implementation, or they're... So it seems kind of work. I haven't used it. And the core boot thing, I think they have the basic. So there was another talk about core boot, RISC-V workshop. Ron Minnick gave the talk. He's kind of the core boot guy. And so they have a basic RISC-V core boot implementation. So.
Because the UEFI is closed, right?
No, there's open implementation. It's an open standard. And there's Tiano core, which is an EDK2. It's not the same thing. That's an open implementation. So they've been porting that to RISC-V. So. And that's sort of, that's on ARM-V8 systems, server class ARM systems, that's kind of the standard way to boot. John Masters, who many of you probably know, worked on that specification, so he was at the RISC-V workshop, and so he was kind of pushing UEFI as kind of the standard for at least server class desktop machines. So yeah, that was actually kind of impressive. It was kind of cool that HP is actually put some resources behind that, and Ron Minnick, who is now at Google, has been doing some stuff there too. So that stuff's actually coming along.
All right.
Okay, thank you.